Happy Sabbath and happy World Pathfinder Day, everybody. Keep it down, Zark. You're listening to Word SBC 88.3 FM. Hey, PowerPointers, what's up? It's your favorite uncle, Uncle PJ, with another PowerPoint for today. And here it is. It says, victory is a gift from God, not a product of our strength. You know, that's interesting. You know, sometimes we feel as though we are strong enough to handle any situation. But guess what? Our strength is not within ourselves. It's from God and God alone. You know, the song says, you are my strength, strength like no other. And then there's a song that says, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. Is he your Lord of everything? So guess what? Whenever those challenges come, whatever it is that you will face today and even throughout this weekend, you know, World Pathfinder Day, we celebrate 72 years under the theme, Change the World. We are all change agents. And guess what? It only can happen through the strength of Christ Jesus and Christ Jesus alone. And as I go, I want to leave this scripture with you. And it says 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 9. And it says, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Listen, what a powerful word from God, that our strength is only from him and him alone. All we have to do is ask, and he will do it for us. So once again, it's your favorite uncle, Uncle
Before
PJ.
Before he and says that, it's Uncle PJ, your favorite uncle's birthday. So at this time, we're going to say happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to Uncle PJ. Happy birthday to Uncle PJ. And I'm out.
Once again, it's your favorite uncle, Uncle PJ, with another PowerPoint for today. God bless you.
Mission Pinwheels. Have you ever seen a pinwheel? Have you made a pinwheel or held one in your hands? One morning, little Samuel found himself holding not just one pinwheel, but two in his hands. How did he end up with two pinwheels? Samuel went with his mother to a special morning worship in Sao Paulo, Brazil. During the worship, a man told a nice story about pinwheels and God. At the end of the story, the man gave Samuel a red, green, yellow, black, and white pinwheel. Then he gave the boy a second pinwheel. Give this second pinwheel to a little friend, he said. Tell your friend about pinwheels and God. Samuel knew exactly who he wanted to give the red, green, yellow, black, and white pinwheel to. There was a boy named Peter at his public school. He could give the pinwheel to him. He could tell him about pinwheels and God. Samuel spoke with mother. Can I give the pinwheel to Peter? He asked. Mother thought it was a good idea. Samuel could be a real missionary, sharing the pinwheel and telling Peter about God. But first, mother spoke with Peter's mother. She wanted to make sure that Peter's mother wouldn't mind the gift. Peter's mother didn't mind. Then mother had another idea. Samuel, she said, let's make a nice present for Peter. We can put the pinwheel into a box with a fun DVD about how to be a healthy boy. Then we can wrap up the box. Samuel liked the idea. Mother placed the pinwheel and the DVD in a box and wrapped it in nice paper. The next day at school, Samuel happily gave the present to Peter. He told Peter about pinwheels and God. Peter was so pleased. He liked the red, green, yellow, black, and white pinwheel very much. A short time later, Samuel's church held a special children's program where all the children could make pinwheels. Samuel invited Peter to make pinwheels at the church. It was a fun day for Peter and Samuel. In the morning, they and other children made pinwheels. In the afternoon, they sang songs about Jesus to old people in a nursing home. From that day, Samuel and Peter became best friends. Peter went to church with Samuel every Sabbath. He joined the Adventurers Club with Samuel. Peter had an older sister, Sarah, and she also started coming to the Pathfinders Club. Then Peter's mother started coming to church to watch the Adventurers and Pathfinders. Soon Peter's older sister, Sarah, gave her heart to Jesus and was baptized. After that, Peter's mother and father gave their hearts to Jesus and were baptized. Today, Peter comes to church every Sabbath with his whole family. His mother teaches the kindergarten class and is a leader of the Adventurers. His father is a church deacon. His sister teaches the junior class. And Peter himself is a very good student with Samuel in the primary class. Peter and Samuel are best friends. Samuel is a real missionary. God used him to bring salvation to Peter's house and family. Part of the 13th Sabbath offering this quarter will help open 4 new churches in Samuel's country of Brazil. Thank you for planning a generous offering next Sabbath.
Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Your life frees me to sing.
Your life frees me to sing.
I will praise you all my day.
I will praise you all my day.
You're perfect in all your ways.
You're perfect in all your ways.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your word.
I will obey your word.
I want to see your kingdom come.
I want to see your kingdom come.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You take me into the land.
You take me into the land.
We will conquer in your name.
We will conquer in your name.
And proclaim that Jesus reigns.
And proclaim that Jesus reigns.
Hail, hail, line of Judah.
Hail, hail, line of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
Hail, hail.
Welcome to PowerPoint Sabbath School. I hope that our returning viewers are ready to enjoy this week's lesson. Victory and defeat. Samson, now taken captive by the Philistines, was imprisoned in chains, grinding wheat in the mill. He sat and thought of old when he had strength. He remembered when he took the hinges off the Philistines' gate, or when he defeated an army of 1,000 Philistine men with the jaw of a donkey. Outside, the Philistines were celebrating his capture to their god, Dagon. Reminiscing the days with his former strength, Samson prayed to God to restore his strength for one last time so that he can fulfill the purpose God had for him, defeating the Philistines. Samson then decided what he had to do. He called for the help of God to take him to the temple where the Philistines were celebrating. Samson then used the strength God had given him and pushed the pillars. The temple came crashing down on both him and the Philistines. He had fulfilled what God had him to do. Moving on to our PowerPoint and power text. The PowerPoint is, victory is a gift from God, not a product of our own strength. The power text is, but thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 7.
On the panel today is Kezia the hostess, Nathaniel and Shevon, and Director Sterling Johnson, our guest, and myself, Marcia. Before we start, let us pray. Our most gracious Father, can you please let us reach others around the world with your word, and can you please let it touch their heart and motivate them to change? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. It's discussion time. Question one. In the lesson, we see Samson ashamed of how his actions has brought mockery to God's name. Can you give an account of when your actions brought shame unto God or his name?
Well, I think that, like cheating on a test, like you're supposed to tell the truth at all times, but if anything, you're lying to your teachers and you're lying to yourself because you're lying to the teachers because the teachers are like, oh, you got a good grade. They stopped Nathaniel. You're lying by cheating. And also you're lying to yourself being like, oh, I aced that test. No, you did not ace that test. You just looked at answers and wrote on the test. That's all you did. And that's bringing mockery to God's name because that's not what he told us to do. Some people think they slick.
I can think of a time when my action brought shame to God's name. And there have been several times when my action, I might have gotten in a conversation that I had no business getting into. And so persons would normally say, would say to me, I mean, even on yesterday, I think my action brought shame or mockery to God's name because my sister had sent me a receipt that she wanted me to look at to, and she sent it on Sabbath. But she didn't send it for me to look at it on Sabbath, but she sent it to me. So when I got home from church, I went into my WhatsApp and I saw that receipt and I called her and she was like, it's your Sabbath. Why are you looking at receipts? And so I feel like, you know, my action then, because she's not a Seventh-day Adventist, she sent it to me, not for me to look at it at that time. She just sent it. And as a Seventh-day Adventist, you know, it wasn't the time for me to do that. And so at that time, I had to quickly repent and say, Lord, you know, I really should not be doing that. And she shouldn't have to rebuke me. And if a non-Adventist is rebuking me or a non-Seventh-day Adventist is rebuking me about the things, about the truths that I share, then that brings shame and mockery to what I believe, to God or his name.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I think a time when I may have brought shame or mockery to God's name is, well, several times I have. And I think a time when I did was in grade 6. And I had this theory that because my mom was not at the school that I attended, she would never know the things that I did at school. And I remember I would eat pepperoni pizza and I would eat corn dogs, which had pork in them. And I could have sworn it's not because I thought that God would never know, but it was mainly in fear of my mother that she would never find out. I was like, oh, she'll never find out, so I can do what I want to do, not realizing that it's actually not her who said not to eat pork, but it's actually God who said not to eat pork. And I think that brought shame and mockery to God's name. And it wasn't in the case where, like, friends of mine would say, oh, you're not supposed to be eating that. It was just more, nor teachers. Nobody said anything to me. I just was eating what I wanted to eat. And I think I had just told my mom, like I think in grade 7 or grade 8 when I had told that I was doing this stuff at school. And I mean, from now on, like, I know not to eat pork and I know it's a bad thing. Sometimes, like, it'll be in foods that I don't know and I eat it and I ask God to forgive me, but it's not purposely now. I no longer go and to the tuck shop or whatever and get pepperoni pizza anymore. And also, like, now when I'm old, like at my new school, it's more of if I eat beef and they mistake Seventh-day Adventists to not eat beef, they associate us with not eating beef and pork, not realizing that we actually can eat beef and chicken and stuff like that. I've had instances where I would be eating beef at school And my friends would literally come to me and like almost shouting at me, why are you eating beef? You are not supposed to be eating beef because you are a Seventh-day Adventist. So like now I know, I do have to correct them and say, yes, I can eat beef. But I know now, like, more than anything, I cannot try to deviate from what God says, because not only he says this, but also people are watching my every move. So I think those are some times when I did bring shame to God's name.
I can remember a time where it was about the time when we were still online for grade 7, the first part of grade 7, we were still online, and my aunt was not at home, and I thought that if I just watched something, she wouldn't know when I didn't know that she had a plan to find out what I did when she came back. So I was watching a video. And when I saw the car came back into the yard, I switched it back on to the work. So and when she came and checked the tag, you know, she found out that I was watching a video.
Like everybody, I have like numerous encounters of when I did things that I felt really brought mockery to God. And yesterday, I can remember yesterday, I was just feeling really grumpy, and I could actually feel within myself that I feel that my attitude or mood wasn't right. And then I may have said some things that wasn't really right in character. And then I had to let myself chill out and calm myself down, and then I had to pray to God, ask him, Lord, please help me ease that anger. And then I had to remember, I think it's the verse in James, and it says to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. So I think that's something that calmed me down. But I think that's one time that really brought mockery to God, because that's something that I'm supposed to know, and I'm supposed to hurry up and deal with already. The second question is, but thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 7. Were you ever faced with a challenge or temptation where it was only the victory and strength that God had given you that allowed you to break free? If so, please share.
So first, I would say that there was a certain sin that I constantly kept like repeating. Well, not repeating actually, it was just something. Well, anyway, it was a sin or a temptation, whatever it was. And, you know, you just have to go to God and pray, like earnestly go to him and pray. And I think with the help of the Holy Spirit and also just your conscience and you realizing that you made a promise to God that you will never fall back into this sin again, or you will never continue doing this thing. So, for example, like I've had this thing with like Shevon as well. Like I would be on my laptop, and it's not necessarily a sin, but I was supposed to be on my laptop doing work, but I'm also watching videos on YouTube, and I switch back. And sometimes you have to just say no. And I think that's kind of similar to when you're in sin and you just have to realize that you have to say no. And also with the help of God, and just realizing and remembering that when you pray that prayer, saying that you will never go fall back into that sin again, you have to remember that prayer that you, and that promise that you made, because now you're breaking a vow and you have to keep that vow. Till death do us part. Basically, you made that promise for life and you will never fall back into that. So you have to always remember when that temptation comes, you have to ask for the strength of the Holy Spirit. And also you must remember that promise that you made to God.
And thanks be to God who has given us, and not just thanks be to God, thanks be to God who has given us the victory. Because if it wasn't for him giving us the victory over sin and through our Lord Jesus Christ, each day we do these little things, little white lies, and society has it now that makes it seem like, okay, you can do this and you can do that, and it's no effect anymore. Especially with the advancement of social media, young people, we sometimes get, even as adults, we sometimes get into telling little white lies, making little jokes on persons that kind of, that hurt somebody else and even hurt our character. And there are people that are always looking at us and saying, she's lying, she's not telling the truth, because sometimes people know. And so one of the things that I knew that was a challenge for me that I used to do is, like, I didn't get something done, like for work or something, and I try to make up a story as to why I didn't get it done. And the Lord had to convict me of that and has given me the victory over that. So I'm like, if I didn't get it done now, I go to my work and I say, I'm sorry I wasn't able to get it done, but can you give me a little bit more time and I'll get it done this afternoon or whatever the case may be. But we don't have to, we can gain the victory by standing up and being bold for God. And that's, you know, as we are celebrating Pathfinder Day this week, it's saying to change the world. We can only change the world when we would have gotten that victory over those little sins that has set us so far away from God.
On the Christian journey, everyone knows that there are a lot of trials and tribulations and temptations that we go through. So I really have my fair share, and something like a temptation or a challenge I've been dealing with is discipline. And because school has now started back, so that means I have to recalibrate everything that I've been doing. No more staying up late, sleeping late. I have to be prepared and more. And that really takes a lot of discipline, because if you're like a very loose person and don't care for nothing, and then you don't pack your bag for the next morning, or you don't prepare what you need to do for the next morning, then it'll pile up on you. And that's something that I really needed to go ask God for strength for, because on your own, you think you could do it, and then you'll be like, okay, I'll go to bed at this certain time, and then it's past that time, and then you're like, oh my goodness, I didn't do it. So sincerely praying to God and asking him for the strength to give me discipline, and my sleep schedule has really, really been good for me. Is there any more inputs? Okay. Question 3. Samson let his entertainment and pleasure take the place and gain more importance than God in his life. Have you ever experienced this? And what advice do you give to others struggling with the same thing? I'll repeat again. Samson let his entertainment and pleasure take the place and gain more importance than God in his life. Have you ever experienced this? And what advice do you give to others struggling with the same thing?
Well, I think sometimes, like, there's another thing relating to school, like getting too much of good grades and start studying, like, y'all, I got an A plus on my Spanish test, I got an A plus on my English test. Oh, I also got an A plus on my math test. Let's see if I get an A plus on my science test one. You know what? I already got so many A pluses, I don't even need to study for them. You know, I'm just gonna get an A plus automatically. I'm accustomed to having A pluses as soon as the test comes. Hey, what are these questions one? I don't know any of this. What is this? And then you just get a zero. So my advice is to not getting too confident, because it's God who gives us everything, and that it's not us. And so we need to study, because God gives us the strength, and we also have to do our part too. That's what I have to say.
It is the same as Nathaniel said. If God help you with your study, but if you do not study yourself, God will not help you because he helps you to do a part way and you must do your part as well. So when you're in an exam and you pray, God will help you to remember what you have studied.
So I agree with Nathaniel on that. And yes, I have experienced that. I have experienced where entertainment takes the place of God in my life. But to anybody who is, any advice to anybody who is going through that, basically just remember that God created all things, like Nathaniel said, and also to remember that in the end, you won't have any of these things to rely on. And I know in the last days and the judgment days, the clock is literally ticking. And we know that at a certain point in the end days, if we live to see the end days, we know that we are going to have to hide the word of God in our hearts, because whether Bibles will be banned, we cannot use our Bibles and we can't have them on our phones anymore. And we can't have the paper Bibles there. Executing us because of it, we have to realize that at this time we have to put away all the entertainment, because there is going to be a time for that. But at this very moment, I feel like we should be using more of our time in God's words, because the time is drawing near and entertainment is not even going to matter anymore at that point. So we just always have to remember that.
I'd like to add to that. And I'm just thinking about that young people, you know, can have entertainment, can have godly entertainment, entertainment that glorifies God. And that form of entertainment will not take the place of God in your life. It would include God in your life. And so I want to encourage young people that you find godly entertainment, godly jokes. There are jokes in the Bible that you could laugh at. There are jokes that, because I sometimes say that God has a sense of humor, because I mean, some things I see happen in the Bible, only God, you know? So I give God, we can find godly entertainment, you know, and I'm not one of the adults who feel like, okay, adults, children should not have this fun and children should not play or children should not. I'm not that adult that feels like children should just, you know, sit in a corner, especially on Sabbath, and not do anything. So I feel like if we can include godly entertainment in our lives, then that kind of entertainment will not take the place of God. And my advice to those who are placing entertainment or daily attainments or daily things that happen in your life, like, you know, you did well in school and you put that, you become so heady and you feel like, okay, but it is God. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 7, not to be wise in your own eyes, you know, but let me quickly read that. It says, be not wise in thine own eyes. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to our bodies and our minds. So we ought to be careful how we let these things of the world become so much a part of us that we take God out of the picture. Always remember that there is always a God factor in whatever you achieve in life or whatever you do. Make sure that God is the center of it all.
Yay.
Yes, I agree with you all. I really agree with you all. Believe it or not, this is something I really, really struggled with this week. So when I was preparing for the lesson, I was like, God, he wanted me to talk about this and how I'm overcoming this and sharing with others. But I have a schedule that where every time I wake up, I read my Bible, do morning devotion, I read a devotional book, and then the same thing before I go to bed. And I like reading, so I found this interesting book, and Sundays for school, I wake up earlier than expected. And then the first thing I'll do is read the book. And then I'll get like, oh no, I have the bar. And I had that really been happening like all week. And then I was like, God, please give me the strength so I can stop doing this, because I really need to prioritize you. I really need to prioritize you in my life. So the first thing that I advise is more prayer, more power, because you won't have the victory if you just like notice that you have to do it, but then you're not praying to God for you to overcome it, because that way you won't ever overcome it. And the second thing is be honest to God with your feelings, because I journal, and once I notice that there's a problem, and you know, the book is quite interesting, and it's like kind of hard to stop, but me being knowing that what I have to do now, I told God that, yes, Lord, it is hard to stop, but I know what I have to do now. And the third thing I would do is have the attention to change and prioritize God in your life, because once you pray, you told God your feelings, then you should have enough motivation to change and have the intention to put God as your number one in your life and change it. And I think that was the problem with Samson, because he got distracted with Delilah, and then he ended up telling his secrets to the Philistine, and then the thing that God gave him strength, and then it went away because he prioritized his pleasure or his love for Delilah, and then it got him blind. And also, agreeing with Kezia, the thing that I really have in the back of my mind is like, God is coming soon, so I really don't have any time to waste. Yes, I'm glad he placed entertainment in this world, but they are really not important, no matter what. So that's like the thing that wakes me up and tells me, Marcia, it's time to get your act together. And especially how the whole host on this platform, I really can't be slacking off and try to not prioritize God if it's not my duty now to share God to others. So I must keep on prioritizing God and learning more about him, getting him speak through me so that I can help others. Go ahead, Shevon.
And I think that something was wrong, because he made a relationship that got between him and God, because he told God's secret to Delilah.
I would like to add on what Marcia is saying. And it's so funny at the same time. And it's nothing like God looks down on humans and say, we're so silly. Because I would be doing something that I know is wrong. And I would just get this out of the blue thought. And I'm like, God is coming soon. Not even soon. I don't even know when he's coming. The end is, I'm literally almost here, and we are seeing the signs of the times, and God could come through the sky any second now, and all you can hear is the sky start lighting up, and you hear trumpets, and you're like, oh no. You have to realize that at any second now, God could come, because no one knows the day, nor the hour, nor the second, nor the minute. So we gotta be prepared and just know that you're always doing the right thing. And just know that if anybody were to come and ask you, or if the God were to come now, know that you are ready to go with him. And it's not like, oh, I have to do this first. And oh, I have to do that first. Just make sure your life is right all together. So that if God were to come, there'll be no ifs, ands, and buts about it. You are definitely sure you will be going with him.
One point before you go on, Marcia, is that Marcia said we have to be intentional about serving God. And that is a serious and a very strong point. And a lot of young people don't understand this intentionality. We have to know that we are going to serve God. We have to make up our minds to serve him regardless of what others are saying, regardless of what others are doing. regardless of how we look to the world, we have to be intentional about serving God every day, all day.
The last and final question is, but he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly with my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. 2 Corinthians 12:9, New International Version. In our weakness, we find strength in Jesus. When faced with challenges in our flesh, where do you find yourself seeking strength from?
I'll go ahead. As a person, as a mortal human being, I know that I find myself going in a way where I know I should not be, and trying to find strength in myself. And although I know that it's wrong, you have to catch yourself before you wreck yourself. Because if I'm in a predicament, instead of going to God and seeking Him, I seek to myself. Either I cry and have a pity party, and then I claim that I'm okay. But really and truly, I'm not. And when I do end up catching myself, I just say, hey, I'm humble now. I no longer seek to find strength in myself, but now I want to find strength in you. So God, please lead me and guide me. And I think there's something with God is that I could be wrong, honestly. I just think if He knows, I'm not wrong. I think I'm very right. I think He knows all of our circumstances. I think He knows all of our troubles. It's just He's waiting for us to come and be humble and ask Him for help. And that is a serious thing, because pride gets us nowhere. And I think when I try to find strength in myself, I'm being prideful, I'm not being humble. And God loves somebody with a meek spirit. So I humble myself before Him, and I try to find strength in Him as best as I can. And when I do remember, I try to go to Him.
I think that one of the things I wish that I would have is because I am kind of shy, I suppose. I have been to a lot of camps and churches that I have preached at, and when I am going to do the preaching, I get really nervous. So I wish that I would not be shy.
Reading this text from the Christian Standard Bible, it says, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, and my power is perfected in weakness. Therefore, I will most gladly boast all the more about my weaknesses. Sometimes we don't talk about our weaknesses. Sometimes we don't say that we have a weakness. Sometimes we don't say, like Shevon is able to say, I am shy and I feel weak when I have to go and preach in front of an audience that I may not know. We're not ready to say, I struggle with lying. Like Marcia is ready to say, I struggle with, not getting there in the mornings and not being where I'm supposed to be. We have to be able to talk about our weakness, because that is when we can go to God, because then we can empty ourselves. We can become vulnerable before God, and we can empty ourselves and say, God, I fell down here in this. I am weak in this. And we are to, and as older folks, adults, we don't want to tell you kids that we have weaknesses. Yes, we have weaknesses. We struggle too. We want to play perfect, and we are not perfect, because our perfection, we are made perfect in Christ by His grace. So all of us, your mummies, your daddies, we have weaknesses, and sometimes we don't tell our young people, and our young people grow up with this false thing that they are supposed to be this good Christian child. And they, yes, you are to be, but yes, you have weaknesses. And when Paul is saying that, I boast in my weakness, because it's that time that I boast in my weakness that I can find the strength that God is able to help me to overcome and to win the victory over this. Do I make any sense, Marcia?
I really, really agree with everyone. I kind of like to pose the question from the PowerPoint that says, victory is a gift from God, not a product of our own strength. And like Kezia, sometimes when I face the challenges, I look to myself and I'm like, Marcia, you can do it. I mean, affirmation is important. Yes, affirmation important. But sometimes my independence can get the better of me. And then I don't rely on anybody. I don't even turn to God. And then everything results in turmoil and disaster. I'm distressed. I'm just bottled up and overwhelmed with emotion. And then I forget that God is right there with me. And through this time of weakness, He is my strength. He's right there. He's gonna help me through. And I also find myself too, when I'm feeling down, I listen to the music that really resonates within me. Instead of going to God and praying, I'm going to be there. Because one thing, I mean, I notice this every time it happens, but it's like I'm brainwashed over and over again. God, every time I go to God, there's just this sense of relief that washes over me, that He's right there. He's going to give me strength. I don't need to turn to the things of this world, to the pressure of this world. He's my strength. He's right there. And all I have to do is humble myself, like Katie said, and go to Him, or remind myself that He is right there and I can access Him all the time. I just have to call upon His name and He will be my strength.
You guys have me all almost teared up right now, you know, just listening to you young people. And I think that was Marcia's last question. Marcia, is that your last question? I just want to say to you guys, you pathfinders, whether you're in uniform today or not, your pathfinders are doing an awesome job. You are raising a standard, lifting up the bar so high, you know, and I just want to congratulate you pathfinders today for coming out and always being here every Sunday and recording and sharing God's message and living that actually changing the world, changing your world one day at a time. Every Sabbath, you come on and you share this PowerPoint Sabbath School with friends. You are sharing Jesus and you're actually living out the Pathfinder pledge. By the grace of God, I will be pure, kind, and true. I will be a servant to God and a friend to man. And you are being servants of God by sharing the message of God's word each day. I want to congratulate you Pathfinders today. I want to congratulate Pathfinders around the world on this 72nd World Pathfinder Day. I want to thank you guys for being an awesome part of God's ministry and sharing His word Sabbath after Sabbath. I think you ought to give yourselves a round of applause. Give yourselves a round of applause. And I clap for you guys because you guys are awesome. God is happy with you. I am so proud of you. And so as you celebrate World Pathfinder Day around the world, wherever you are, go and change your world. One Sabbath school lesson, one student, one friend at a time. And happy World Pathfinder Day.
Whoa!
That was the rest of the questions. I will now turn it over to Kezia for the announcement.
Thank you so much, Marcia, and thank you so much, Director Johnson, for that greeting. And I also wanted to add just like a little verse. Actually, I'm going to give it after the announcements. But as you all know, PowerPoint is, it is announcement time. But do not fret, because we have more things coming up. So coming up next, we have Pastor DJ and our 28 greats. We also have our special feature, which is most likely going to be quiz time. And I told you guys this last week, but I'll say it again. Unfortunately, Princess Sakel will not be with us this week, but most likely she'll be with us next week or the week after. So please stay tuned for that. Also, a big thank you to Uncle PJ. Thank you so much for being our personnel to do our PowerPoint recap every single week. Thank you so, so much. And PowerPoint is, if you have not ever been on that website, you really need to check it out. So please check out kidsclubproduce.org. Once again, kidsclubproduce.org. We are on there, as well as some awesome other programs as well are on there. So please check that out. And PowerPoint is, I would like to give our subscriber count. Currently, we have 768 subscribers. Thank you all so much for your love and support. We are so grateful. And we know we could not have done this without our Heavenly Father. But we also want to say thank you, a great thank you to all of you guys who shared, liked, and viewed, and to you who subscribed. And like I always say, if you have not subscribed yet, what are you doing? Please subscribe, because you just need to. It's a necessity. So please subscribe to the channel. And the verse that I will leave with you all today is taken from Isaiah 41, verse 10. And it says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. So, PowerPointers and big PowerPointers, if you guys are watching, stay encouraged that God will be with you at all times and he will raise you up with his righteous right hand. Thanks again to Marcia for those awesome questions. I thoroughly enjoyed answering them and hearing our panel's opinions on the question. So thank you, Marcia, for those awesome questions. Thank you, Nathaniel, thank you, Nathaniel and Shevon, for joining us on the program today. And a special thanks to Director Johnson for accompanying us on this very special episode. Once again, before we close, can Shevon please pray for us?
As we pray. Dear kind and merciful Father, thank you for bringing us today once again throughout another week. I pray, dear Lord, that as we're about to continue our day, pray that you continue to guide and protect us, be it by the forces of darkness, accidents, danger, and trouble, with many own powers. And I pray, dear Lord, that we will be more like you. We will not let any relationship get between you and us, dear Lord. I pray, dear Lord, that we will continue to serve you, that we will enjoy doing the work that you are giving to us. Forgive us for all our sins. Continue to provide for us our basic needs. And I pray, dear Lord, that as we close this meeting, someone listening to the hearing of our voices will be blessed, and they will want to join our army. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Shevon, once again, happy Global Pathfinders Day. And remember, you can always change the world. Remember that God loves you and we love you as well. Stay safe and bye.
Pathfinders from all over the globe, are you ready for World Pathfinder Day 2022? every day, we should be pathfinders who want to make a difference and share Jesus' love with others. This year, we are challenging you, Pathfinder, to change the world. You must be fearless, you must be committed, and above all, you must trust in God. He is the one who has called you to go and share the beauty of the gospel, to go and change lives with His love. We know that you can change the world. You are Pathfinder Strong. See you all September 17, 2022 for World Pathfinder Day.